Despite all the noise and smoke and wreckage caused by our attack on the Capitol, only 61 persons were killed. We learned from later news reports. Among these are two congressmen, one sub-cabinet official, and four or five senior congressional staffers. But the real value of all our attacks today lies in the psychological impact, not in the immediate casualties. For one thing, our efforts against the system gained immeasurably in credibility. More important, though, is what we taught the politicians and the bureaucrats. They learned this afternoon that not one of them is beyond our reach. So that was written more or less 40 years ago. It was the book Turner Diaries. Turner Diaries, a book written by William Pierce, a prominent neo-Nazi member and the leader of the American neo-Nazi organization National Alliance. The plot is quite easy of the book, actually. America, the American system, is attacking the white Aryan people. And of course, it is dominated by the Jews. And the Jews use black people or immigrants in order to impose the new American political correct system on the Aryan people. The Aryan people react. They take the power in the United States, and through the use of nuclear weapons, they also dominate the world. That is more or less the plot. But the thing is that this book, even though it is just a novel, if it is only literature, it has managed to become, according to the FBI, the Bible of the extreme right in the United States, and from what we know also in Europe. And that's why when I saw the riots in the Capitol, I also saw some nooses erected in front across the Capitol. And that reminded me of another passage of the book that was the Day of the Rope. The Day of the Rope is the day when the Aryan people will hang all the Jews, all the non-white, or even the, as they call, the traitors of the race. So you can understand that seeing all these things happening in the Capitol was quite shocking, mostly because you said something was written 40 years ago and suddenly we see that it could also be a prophecy. So the first thing that we should ask ourselves is whether all those people participated in the riot are truly in favor of white supremacy, that they are truly neo-Nazi, neo-fascists. And this is where a very interesting survey and a very interesting research appeared. The Chicago Project on Security and Threat conducted a thorough research after the events concerning the profile of the people that participated in the riot. And I would like here to say that some of the results that they have found, some of the findings are really interesting. So I will just quote four of them. The first one is, and I quote the research, "What we are dealing with here is not merely a mix of right-wing organizations, but a broader mass movement with violence at its core. Second one, this is fundamentally a political movement. The third finding, the vast majority have no connection to existing far-right militias or groups. Normal pro-Trump activists joined with the far-right to form a new kind of violent mass movement. And the fourth one, storming the US Capitol was an act of political violence, not merely vandalism or trespassing for other purposes." This is quite interesting. Why? Because first of all, at least from my point of view, when I saw the attack, you could see that it was like from a Lord of the Rings movies. There were shamans, there were people dressed, there were people that come with Christian flags, with Nazi emblems, with other people with a Confederate flag. So you would say that was like the army of Sauron attacking humanity. The thing is that it would be a parody, but they left behind five dead people. And apart from that, they also proved that they could actually enter into the Capitol. So it's not that funny. Aesthetically speaking, it was a tragedy, but then you could also see that people had guns and people were not afraid to show their faces. So this is a new political reality. And from the findings, we can also see that this is actually a new kind of movement, a new kind of a violent movement. Why? Because only 10% of those people were actually connected to the Proud Boys, for example, or the Aryan Nation. The 90% of them were angry people. That's why in the research, they also said that we are dealing with a new phenomenon. So actually now what we have to do is not to try to show whether they have economic problems, whether we can help them psychologically. We have to control their anger. And this, in my opinion, one of the most important characteristics. But what we saw was an outburst of rage. It wasn't an ideology. It wasn't a clearly defined neo-Nazism. It was just pure wrath against the political system, the American values, and its institutions. So, having seen also the situation in Greece with the neo-Nazi, we saw the Golden Dawn. And here I would like just to make a quick comparison. When Golden Dawn entered into the parliament, everyone started talking about the Golden Dawn. They said, this is a tragedy. How could they enter? But that was also beneficial for the democratic values. Why? Because finally, they could see everything that party was doing. And after 5-6 years, well, they went to jail. Their way of acting was always violent. They had no idea whether they could act in another way or not. So violence was the only way. Still, very few people talked about the Golden Dawn, for example, 20 years ago, when it was actually, for example, Yugoslavia or in Srebrenica, when Golden Dawn, for example, dominated the Greek streets. So what is the thing that, and this is why I'm also interested in the case of the capital, when violent or when extremism appears, you know that you can control it. You know that you can see it. You can find its mistakes. You can find its weaknesses. You can find the way they act and they react. But what happens when you cannot see it? Because it's my opinion, it's always a dialectical process. That means that when something appears, something else disappears, but it's still hidden. So my question is, what is happening underground? Now that we know that the Proud Boys are outside, now that we know that Milos Yiannopoulos is there, now that we know that Steve Bannon is out there speaking, who are underground? And that's why here I would like to mention two really important, from my point of view, but also extreme movements in the United States. The first one is called Atom Waffen Division. And even though it was supposed to become illegal in 2020, now it's called National Socialist Order, and it works in the same way. So Atom Waffen Division was founded in 2015. And it's really interesting that it emerged from a neo-Nazi online message board called Iron March. And that board was founded in 2011. So Atom Waffen Division represents the apotheosis of white supremacy extremism in the digital age. And they were trying to communicate with people online through the social network. They tried to approach the people, especially young people from universities, through platforms or through games. But from 2015 on, it became much more material. They were on the streets. And that's why they got the attention of the FBI. And the FBI accused them of more than eight assassinations of people. And most importantly, they really became famous when in January 2018, they killed Blaise Bernstein, a member of the Atom Waffen Division called Samuel Woodward, killed Blaise Bernstein. That was an 18-year gay, and that he was also Jew. So those were the characteristics that, according to the Atom Waffen Division, proved to be lethal for his existence, and they killed him. That's it. This is when the Atom Waffen Division became really famous, well, infamous actually in the United States, and this is when they started actually hunting them down. So why is this group so important? First of all, it doesn't have many members. It could be around 80 members, 100 members. But still, when we see its vocabulary, when we see the way that it expresses its ideology, it could be one of the most extreme things that we have seen in the postmodern age, not to say the modern age. They are in favor of accelerationism. What is this? Of the extreme right accelerationism. They want to provoke chaos. They want to kill people, innocent. It doesn't matter. They want to destabilize the modern society and all of its values and pillars. Why? In order to create the proper conditions for a race war. And we were speaking a race war. We go back to the Turner Diaries and we see that it would be a genocide of everyone that is not white or that is not Aryan. So this is their vocabulary. But apart from the vocabulary and apart from their theoretical point of views, we've seen that they've been accused for assassinating people. But still, most importantly, they have become an international movement. They have, for example, their offshoot in United Kingdom with Sonnenkrieg Division. And you can see that now it's supposed to be a terrorist organization and most of its members are 16 or 18 years old. And it was also interesting that when Prince Harry got married to Meghan Markle, they were the ones that threatened to kill him, telling him that you are a traitor of your own race, and they wanted to behead him. So, going on, what is the ideology of the Atom Waffen Division? They are in favor of the destruction of the water world as we know it. They are in favor of taking the arms and attacking everyone, or killing everyone, even innocent people that are not white or Aryan white. But still, when we are speaking about white people, they can't be the traitors of the race. That's it. For example, they cannot be associated with Jews, not with Muslims. So more or less, it is a totalitarian point of view when we see it in terms of ideology, but they become even more dangerous. Why? Because they sent some of their members to the Azov battalion in Ukraine. And finally, they got them and Ukraine sent them back. But also the appearance and the emergence of the Azov battalion is crucial for understanding the way that transnational nationalism is working. Why? Because during their conflict with the Russian, they can now offer the know-how, the military know-how, and even the ideological know-how to other people or to other militants. So we see that the Atomwaffen Division spread its wings. They went to Europe, they went to Ukraine, and they tried to bring all their know-how to the United States in order to engage into this war of races. Another, aesthetically speaking, really interesting point of view is that when we see the videos posted by this group, they have adopted the aesthetics of the ISIS. That is, they have a posted video whose name is Fission. And then we can see that members with hoods burn the European, the Israeli, and the American flag. And if you see the way that the video is done, the colors, and even the way that the people act, we can totally understand that their rhetoric also comes from the ISIS, their violence, their political discourse, and their theoretical discourse. So this is probably one of the most important movements, neo-Nazi and extremist movements that actually are in the United States. The other one, it is the base. The base is mostly an online neo-Nazi extremist movement in favor as well of accelerationalism, but its leader, whose name it is Rinaldo Nazzaro, if I remember well, he's not in the United States, he is in Russia. So this is also another important element. He has tried to create his own agenda, his own anti-American and in favor of the Aryan discourse from Russia. And the problem is that he also has the know-how, because before that, he had a private organization giving advice on subject of intelligence, counter-terrorism. So he were using a lot of alliances, and what he was trying to do was to recruit young people. Once again, we see that the target group are young people. They try to approach young people, telling them or trying to convince them that actually this world is not worth living, so you can kill freely. And I'm not exaggerating. When we see the vocabulary, when we see their aesthetics, and when we see their discourse, they are attacking the border world as a totality. There are no innocent people, because everyone is supposed to be a member of this corrupted society. And going on now, we've seen so far the base, we have seen also the Atomwaffen Division, and we'll try now to see who is their leader, who is their spiritual leader, where do they get their ideas from? And here we have a name and a surname, and that is James Mason. James Mason, it's, I wouldn't say interesting, but a quite notorious guy. He's a prominent neo-Nazi member of different groups in the United States. He was also a member of the formerly known as American Nazi Party. And he was writing many different articles in favor of Hitler, in favor of white supremacy. And he finally published them all in a book called Siege. This book, more or less 400 pages, I'd say, has become the Bible of the Atomwaffen Division and of the base. And what are its main ideas? First of all, he was the one that coined the term accelerationalism for the extreme right. He was the one saying that actually there is nothing worth saving here, burn everything, we have to create a new future. He is the one that in his articles praised Hitler and praised. Actually, he has, I think, more than 30 articles about Hitler. He considers Hitler to be the avatar of the gods. He considers Hitler to be the one that was guiding the Western civilization to its glorious moments. And the third most interesting part that I will later analyze is that he actually proposed and he asked for ideological, I think, guidance from Charles Manson. And the one Charles Manson agreed. So we see that we have a mixture of neo-Nazi elements, white supremacy, and then the crazy, but still very convincing, at least in his circle, ideas of Charles Manson. we are clearly speaking, as we will later see, of a postmodern neo-Nazism, postmodern neo-fascism, and it would be interesting to see whether we can still apply those terms when it comes to those ideological movements. So let's go now to another group, another very strange group that combines everything. And even though it is not in the United States, since it is in the United Kingdom, still it has influence all around Europe, but mostly in the United States. That group is called the Order of the Nine Angles. It's a strange group. According to the US Department of Justice, it is an occult-based neo-Nazi and racially motivated violent extremist group. And they also, they also characterize this group in the following way. The Order of the Nine Angles has expressed, among others, satanic, anarchist, neo-fascist, neo-Nazist, and anti-Semitic beliefs. For example, in one of its texts referred to as the Mass of Heresy, the organization claims Adolf Hitler was sent by our gods to guide us to greatness. We believe in the inequality of races and in the right of the Aryan to live according to the law of the folk. We acknowledge that the story of the Jewish Holocaust is a lie to keep our race in chains and express our desire to see the truth revealed. Is it a big group? No, it isn't. Does it have many members? No, it doesn't, but I also believe that they don't want many members. But are they important? Yes, and we can see this in the States. For example, in June in 2020, a US soldier, Ethan Meltzer, that is 22 years old, was charged with terrorism offenses for planning a deadly ambush on his unit by sending information to the Order of the Nine Angles. So what is the objective of this order, of this satanic, heretic, anarchist order? They want to infiltrate the military fields, the political fields, and also the church and the police stations. Why? Because they also want to destroy all the pillars, I would say, of liberal democracy. They actually tell to their members, go there, learn everything you want about them, and when the situation is ripe, you can also kill them, and not kill them with a gun. They actually propose satanistic rituals. They say that sacrificing a human being is what will take you further on. And they are in favor of a new kind of Aryan being. It would be like a new Aryan Zarathustra, but still influenced both by Satanism and neo-Nazism. So that was the group that also infiltrated the Atomwaffen division. And that is interesting because a member of the Atomwaffen division left the group and also published a 27 pages manifesto accusing the Atomwaffen division not of all the murders, the assassinations, but accusing them of the fact that it has become a worshiper of Satan. And that the de facto leader of the group, that is John Cameron Denton, was obliging the members to read two satanistic books, The Iron Gate and Liber 333. So what we've seen so far, it is a strange panorama of what is the neo-Nazism and extremist movement in the United States. I wouldn't say actually neo-fascist movements because we see that their roots are deeply inside the Nazi movement. I mean, we see no reference to Mussolini, we see no reference even to Spain or Portugal. They have their avatar, Hitler is the avatar, Hitler is to be worshipped one way or another. And apart from the worshipping of Hitler, we have the element of the destruction. We are actually speaking about people that they say that we have to destroy everything, kill everyone, and don't worry about the consequences. So having presented those elements, now I would like to make some comments, or better said, some theoretical questions. First of all, this movement that we see in the United States with all of the above explained movements, it is a postmodern neo-Nazism. It is a postmodern extremist movement. Why? Because, of course, the slaughter and the bloodshed is not something new. For example, when we take a closer look at the Italian Years of Lead, we see that many of the neo-fascist movements use the strategy of what is called stragismo. That is, we kill as many as we can, because the more we kill, the more we threaten the system. And if we threaten the system will have to react. It will react and will react once again, and the bloodshed begins. And we are not speaking only about assassinations. We're speaking in Italy about bombings in train stations, in banks, for example, at noon, or in trains that they were on march. So we see that there was a lot of blood also during the post-war years in Europe, but they all, or most of the movements, had a clear ideological compass. They say, we are, for example, the sons of the Republica di Salò. We are the sons of neo-fascism. So we know what our ideas are. And even in the left side, it was the same thing. For example, with the Red Brigades, they knew what their agenda was. They knew who they were attacking. More or less, their ideology was clear. It was quite political. Of course, in Italy or in Europe, there were some metaphysical elements, and mostly because of Julius Evola, that's supposed to be somehow the spiritual mentor of modern neo-fascism. But still, everything was political. We kill because we want to attack the state. We kill because we want to impose our own neo-fascist system. A neo-fascist system, for example, that was tried years ago during the fascist regime, and we want to bring it back. More or less, plainly said, and also, well, that would be not an exhaustive analysis, that was their ideology. What do we see now in the States? We see people that they want to kill. We see people that they want to destroy. We see people that they want to attack what we can call the modern society. Do they have to propose another system? No. What do they want? To finish the world that the way we know it. That's it, nothing more. Do they have an idea of how tomorrow's world will be? No, they don't. So what do they say? Act, act, kill, and that's it. There is no ideology. There is wrath, there is hate, and there is somehow a strange dystopian utopia in their minds that it is an Aryan world that we do not understand how exactly it's going to be, as we will see. The second question, do they have the potential to create havoc? Do they have the potential actually to materialize their threats? In my opinion, they do. And especially in the States, we've seen that they have the power to do so. We saw, for example, the case of Timothy McVeigh with the Orlando City bombing. And we're speaking about 168 dead people, among them 19 children. We've also seen the very stranger and different case of Una bomber, Theodore Kaczynski, that has become somehow like a prototype or a hero for the extremist movement. Why? Because he also wanted to attack the modern world, though the way that he attacked it was an attack against the technological modern world. And then we have also, now not in the United States, but in Norway, Anders Breivik, that became somehow the idol, that became the new god of the extremist movement. And I quote, the Atomwaffen Division considers Anders Breivik to be the father, Timothy McVeigh to be the son, and Una Bomber to be the Holy Spirit of the modern extremist movement. So they had their points of reference. And also, some years ago, we've seen what happened in New Zealand with Brendan Tarrant, that killed 51 people. They attacked them, and he also published a manifesto speaking about the great replacement, the threat that white or Aryan people are facing because of the expansion of the black, Muslim, or all of the other races. So we see that actually what Turner Diary said, it's becoming a reality, a grim reality. And so this is the second thing that we have to take into account. And finally, the third conclusion is that we are not facing movements or people with a rigid and very well-structured ideology. We see what I would call, for example, liquid ideology. That is, when we go, for example, to the Atomwaffen Division, they started from the Iron March, that was an online forum. When we go to the other organization, the base, we see that it works online mostly. They have some members, but their action is online. We have platforms, for example, like the ones by Steve Bannon in order to promote alt-right. We have Stormfront or other online forums. So what can we see? That, in my opinion, modern extremists doesn't have a truth. A valid truth. It has many different truths. So they adapt to the new reality. They take different elements. They are working or they are developing their whole ideology based on a myth. What is this myth? The Aryan or the white people? The glory of the Aryan people, the glory of the white people that are always suppressed by the forces that impose political correctness and the vocabulary that we see. So finally, what can we understand from this movement? Is there any solution? Is there any way to confront this liquid, this always eternally moving movement? In my opinion, there is. And I will start from a joke because this also shows the lack, the ideological lack of these movements. There was a member of the Golden Dawn called Kassidiaris, a very prominent member, almost one of the leaders of Golden Dawn. In 2013, in the extremist nationalist forum Stormfront, they started speaking about Kassidiaris, and they said, among other extremists, what do you believe? Does he belong to the Aryan race? And then you could see people saying, but I'm not quite sure. You should do a DNA test in order to see whether he's really white or not. Maybe he's a nationalist, but I wouldn't give my daughter to him. And comments like this, it was like a parody, it was like a joke. But this parody demonstrates that we are speaking about movements that they don't have a solid base. They've based their whole ideology on the myth of the white nation, of the myth on the Aryan race. Excellent. So what can we do? Let's see what they understand by race. Let's see what they understand by white. Let's see what they understand even by the word myth. What I mean is that they don't base their whole ideology on philosophers. We've seen, for example, that they've based most of their ideas on Turner Diaries and on James Mason, for example, that also had relationship with minors, and that he also threatened the 16 years old girlfriend he had because he left with a guy from South America. We are not speaking about important or serious political figures. We are speaking about people that write and they endlessly say their opinion, and from them they draw all the conclusions they want. So even one quite important thinker in the neo-fascist movement in the United States, that is Francis Parker Yoke, he's not mentioned, he's nowhere mentioned. Actually, they don't have that many, but one that wrote, for example, the Spenglerian Imperium does not appear in the writings, or probably they cannot even understand him. So what I say is that an idea to confront this phenomenon would be to use their own vocabulary against them. If you try to define race, there are many anthropologists that cannot define exactly what a race means. They don't have an idea of what the race is. And probably among them, they all share different opinions about what a race is. But still, they have created the idea or the concept of the myth. They consider themselves to be the victims of the modern society. So theoretically speaking, it wouldn't be too difficult to break their myth, to prove to them that what they understand as race, what they understand as Aryan nation is different. Because even among different neo-Nazi movements, they have different concepts of race. So for example, in the Turner Diaries, Indians or other races were supposed to be non-white. But if we go to philosophers of Hitler, we see that the Indians or even the Persians are supposed to be the proto-Aryans. So there is a lot to be done there. I mean, there are many myths that we have to debunk. But the thing is that we cannot offer those movements the possibility to consider themselves a solid front. They are not all the same. I mean, a person holding a Christian flag or a Confederate flag doesn't mean that he adopts the ideas of Hitler. They are not all the same. So it would be a danger to label them all in the same way, to put them all inside the same box and say, this is, for example, the enemy of the modern society. They are different. Each one has different ideologies. And that's why we saw that only, I think, 1/10 of the people that enter into the capital were connected to extremist movements. So what can we do? Take a closer look. Try to understand, first of all, the vocabulary they use, and then understand that they have created their own movements based on myths. And if we are not speaking about solid facts or myths, we can clearly attack the myths. So in my opinion, what could be done? Listen to them carefully. Find their myths and destroy their myths. Because if you take away their myth, then they stay without arguments. But as long as we give credits to their myth, as long as we don't try to analyze their myth, the problem is that they will keep building their castles on them. And this is going to be a problem in the future, especially in a country like the United States, where it's not the hardest place to find weapons. So thank you very much for your attention.